Grendel, a descendant of Cain, is the first of three antagonists in the Old English heroic epic Beowulf. The character of Grendel seems to interest modern filmmakers more than the actual hero of the story, Beowulf, because some of the most significant changes that modern adaptations make to the poem are centered on Grendel. But for me, the epic poem is still the more sophisticated work of art. Particularly if you approach it with a psychoanalytic lens, you can see the depth of the character. So I haven't read Michael Crichton's novel, The Eaters of the Dead, but I have seen the film 13th Warrior, and of course I've read Beowulf, and I have seen the Scandinavian piece Beowulf and Grendel 2005. These adaptations, they're not necessarily bad, they don't have the sophistication of the original epic, nor the art. I mean, after all, it is an epic poem, so it was fit to a meter. But in terms of the psychological profile of the first antagonist, Grendel, who seems to be the most important one, he is really the most terrifying because he's basically a window into the dark corners of your own soul. He's bitter, jealous, envious, bare skin clad warriors in the 13th warrior. That's not someone has to really worry about in the first world anymore. A far more dangerous threat is yourself. When you have succumbed to bitterness and despair. And so, you know, I already find Grendel a sympathetic character. He's still a villain, of course. He has to be stopped. But I already find him more terrifying and more sympathetic and a lot more sophisticated because of the characterization in the original epic. It is really a detailed portrayal of the Heart of Darkness, to borrow Joseph Conrad's term. So I'll be looking at analogies in film and myth, a few characters that you'll recognize, including trolls from Norse myth. The trolls are quite similar to Grendel, but they're limited to Norse mythology, although Beowulf is a hero that's shared by the collective Germanic culture milieu of Northern Europe. Both films have historicized the epic, similar to what Troy does with the Iliad. They remove or supplant all the supernatural elements. So in the 13th Warrior, one single mythic creature is replaced by a primitive tribe of people who live as bears and worship the bear as their totem symbol. It's worth noting that the Viking berserkers also wore bear skins and may have dabbled in psychedelics like psilocybin to prepare themselves for battle. That's fascinating, and I see where Crichton may be borrowing some of the source material for these new adversaries for his heroes. But essentially, the story becomes just a story of tribalism, two tribes fighting each other for territory. I don't find that as compelling or powerful as the profile of Grendel in the epic. Interesting, though, it is. In Beowulf and Grendel, the film shows the story from Grendel's perspective with the intent of inspiring pity for the character. There seems to be a case of ethnic cleansing going on here as the Danes are hunting down these troll-like or Neanderthal-like humanoids for whatever reason. I seem to recall they had been stealing livestock. So no doubt ethnic cleansing, given the history in the 20th century, no doubt that's a serious issue. I mean, basically the story is saying don't hate what you don't know and don't kill people. And it's like, yeah, I'm with you, but for everyone else that doesn't live in a war zone, externalizing evil to some roving band of racist warriors just is not quite as powerful. The Grendel is kind of within all of us, if we go into a downward spiral. Furthermore, having empathy is not incompatible with self-defense. After all, motives of revenge, like in from Grendel's perspective, motives of revenge are common for both protagonists and antagonists in films. Ethically, if empathy is a virtue, then by necessity, it has to be extended to everyone for this simple reason. If it's good enough for you not to, say, inflict unnecessary harm for yourself, then you have empathy for yourself. Then it's also good enough for others, unless you're selfish or a sociopath. So I was already there. I think the deeper analysis of Grendel in the poem is weakened by political correctness in this film. And also, if you're going to make a Neanderthal, go all the way. Don't do some kind of halfway compromise. The first and the last encounter between modern people and Neanderthals, that's fascinating. And as an antagonist, the Neanderthal is interested. I mean, they were tough as nails, extraordinarily strong, so much so that you, if you witness their strength from what I've read, it would seem superhuman, or at least peak human. And I think, as far as that goes, The Quest for Fire is a cult classic. It's one of the best films depicting interactions with humans and Neanderthals. I don't think the interactions would go quite as The 13th Warrior or Beowulf and Grendel depict. I think the end of the Neanderthals was not quite so climactic. I think humans just outcompeted them. I don't know if there was a case of full-on ethnic cleansing like in Beowulf and Grendel, but I'm not really sure what Grendel is in that film. They really go out of their way to make you see his perspective, but like I said, I already have empathy for people that are in that frame of mind. I've been there myself. You know, bitter and jealous and envious. Does philosophy is a good tool to deal with that, which Grendel does not do. He continues his downward spiral. So I do have, and this gets into his characterization significantly, in the epic he is described as being descended from Cain. And the story of Cain and Abel in Genesis, very succinct, scarcely over 10 lines, is a pretty powerful warning, you know, problems of bitterness, jealousy, envy, that people, for whatever reason, you know, just a lack of self-awareness, a lack of ethics, bad parenting, I mean, whatever, we've all been there at least once. And so these emotions characterize Grendel in the epic just a lot more effectively than in the films. And I have to say, again, with Beowulf and Grendel, they really go out of their way to make you sympathize with his perspective, and I get it. It was tragic what the Danes did to his family, but that kind of is the villain. I mean, is it not? It's like, who doesn't have some tragedy happen in their life? The villain is just the one guy or woman who wants to use that tragedy and blame society to get what they want. And so, no, I mean, I watched the film, and I'm for the Danes, just like I'm for Beowulf in the epic. Sympathy I do have, but I have sympathy for everyone. That's kind of the value. That's kind of the point of ethics, is you don't pick and choose who you extend your sympathy to. So with that said, done with the adaptations, let's move on to analogies of this character. So Grendel is not specifically a troll, but he is very similar to trolls, which are creatures of Norse myth. They hate sunlight, which you can equate with the modern internet troll. It's not for no reason that we call them trolls, you know, the proverbial troll living in his mother's basement, angry with the world, plotting its destruction. It's like they're not just symbols for darkness, it's symbolic for the darkness, the dark corners of the human heart when you've given in to despair. So, and you can see this in The Hobbit, which, and Lord of the Rings, which has trolls, more insidious, particularly in The Lord of the Rings. In The Hobbit, they're tricked, and Gandalf turns them to stone by keeping them up. So, like I said, Grendel is complicated in the epic. He is, after all, descended from the Cain of Genesis, and he is an outcast. He is an outsider, and I sympathize with that. He's kind of doomed to wander around in the wilderness alone, and it's the principle of the sins of the father being visited upon the offspring, which I always thought was unjust. I don't quite understand how that's just at all. And so, yes, I kind of see why Grendel is as angry as he is. And the passages will illustrate just how just sick he is of people. You know, and as we know, with mass shootings, the perpetrators are like, you don't want to be in their frame of mind. You know, it's not a good place to be. But getting back to this point of the outsider, so it is an archetype. You see this somewhat in Enkidu from the world's first epic, Gilgamesh. He's a guy from the wilderness who's partly civilized by the hero Gilgamesh. He's uncouth, a wild man of sorts who lives with animals, and he's civilized amusingly by a prostitute and alcohol. and then he is Gilgamesh's companion. And it's worth saying also that trolls are not necessarily evil all the time in the Norse myths. In fact, it behooves the people to treat the outsider, the outcast, with some respect and empathy and courtesy, because that goes well for you. In Norse folklore of compassion towards trolls, towards the old spirits of the woods, has been returning a boon to you for your kindness. It's also worth noting that in modern Norwegian, the term for wizard is trollmannen, which, again, I guess gets to the same point that wizards and sorcerers are operating outside of normal society, particularly after Christianity, when these sort of pagan archetypes are pushed out. And so that gets to the broader point of cultures use other cultures to help define what they are by defining what they're not. I mentioned the fact that he's a descendant of Cain. We'll return to that later. It's very important. And lastly, on this point, this may be the most important point I want to convey in this presentation, is the analogies in myth, or just films, modern day films, that don't have anything to do with the epic at all on the surface, but have the most to do with the epic. So when I reread Beowulf, I immediately recognized Grendel, just like I recognized Travis Bickle. There's Robert De Niro right there on the right, iconic character and image, in Taxi Driver, and also Joker, which was made after and closely copied Taxi Driver. In fact, when I first saw Travis Bickle's character, I was blown away, because it's like that was the first time that I had actually seen a character that was speaking to me directly. As a young man who struggled with introversion and loneliness, I get where Grendel's coming from as an outsider looking in on society and having severe problems fitting in. And it's also, so I have sympathy for that, and it's also just the poets of Beowulf had some kind of sage-like prescience, because when you look at Grendel, this bitter guy living with his mom in his basement here, it's a cave, and, you know, wanting to exact vengeance, it's like, this is the modern internet troll, is it not? I mean, it's quite, the similarities are hard to miss here, but I have to say that the single mother in Beowulf and Grendel, and then of course Grendel is raised by a single mom, the stats on single mothers in modern society, they're not good. I was raised by a single mom, and she's honest, hardworking, plenty of virtues, but she made some catastrophic blunders that led to a broken home. And growing up in a broken home, I had to unlearn a lot of bullshit, as a lot of young men who are really struggling with suicide, depression, crime, delinquency, it's a serious issue. And young women, I'm less worried about. They have spokespeople for them. I question their competence and their sincerity, but they have plenty of people speaking for them. The epidemic of disgruntled, bitter young men is pretty serious. And so, when I read Beowulf, I immediately saw that, and it spoke to me pretty directly. So, with that said, it's very important to avoid the downward spiral that we see in Grendel. There is a big difference, I should say, between introversion. I'm still introverted. That's harmless in itself. That's a big difference between that and antisocial behavior. And so, like with the Danes, what do you do with a Grendel, particularly when he's reached the point of no return? It's tragic. I mean, you got to stop him. There's no question about it. But it is like it's worth reaching out to these people when you see them to prevent them from, you know, going off the deep end. I never did. Philosophy and a handful of friends who kind of had been there too and had been through it. But philosophy was essential. Grendel's no philosopher. You know, his mission is to destroy mankind, and so sympathy we have must be stopped nonetheless. So let's look at passages from the epic on Grendel. So again, borrowing Joseph Conrad's phrase, the Heart of Darkness, here let's look at Beowulf's depiction of Grendel's Heart of Darkness. So, it battle waves bided the blasting fire demon before long, then the hottest hatred must sword wrath arise for a woman's husband and father. Then the mighty war spirit endured for a season. This is Grendel we're talking about here. He bore it bitterly. He who bided in darkness, that lighthearted laughter loud in the Danish drinking hall greeted him daily, and so he was deeply envious of the joy and the happiness of the Danes in their meeting hall. They were having a good time. He was not having a good time. And so, have you experienced this? Surely you have at least once, but you don't want to. You kind of want to resist this impulse. Everyone has experienced tragedy, and when someone has a respite from tragedy and is enjoying life, you kind of want to cheer them on. You don't want to do what Grendel is doing here, but it's like, it's natural. He's more human than human here. I mean, in the epic, it's like, I kind of understand him more than Beowulf, but Beowulf is, he's a noble man, but it's like he's almost too perfect. So this is the key passage. For that bitter murder, the killing of Abel, all-ruling father, the kindred of Cain, crushed with his vengeance, in the feud he rejoiced not, but far away drove him from kindred and kind. So this is the fate of Cain, doomed to wander the wilderness, so too Grendel. That crime to atone for, the murder of Abel, meter of justice. Thence, ill-favored creatures, elves and giants. Keep that in mind, elves are not the noble fair heroes in Germanic folklore that they are in Lord of the Rings. Monsters of ocean came into being, and the giants that long time grappled with God. So that's his lineage. Let's see the story in Genesis, Cain of Abel, given that it's so important that Grendel is descended from Cain. Cain is a farmer, Abel is a shepherd, and it is interesting how this conflict between Cain and Abel is replicated throughout history. Farmers and shepherds in ancient Italy, for example, the Samnites and the Romans, farmers and shepherds have had a lot of wars, and there's limited land, but they have two completely different means of using it, so they have to fight over it. So Cain brought an offering from the fruit of the ground to Yahweh, and Abel also brought an offering from the choicest firstlings young of his flock, and Yahweh looked with favor to Abel and his offering, but to Cain nothing. And Cain became quite angry, and his face fell. And Yahweh said to Cain, "Why are you angry, and why is your face fallen? If you do well," this is very important here, "if you do well, will I not accept you? But if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door." So I'll return to this point at the end of the presentation when I kind of look at a way to avoid this dark path. Cain was doing well, and then he becomes jealous, and then here we begin the spiral. Travis Bickle in Taxi Driver describes himself as God's lonely man, and in Taxi Driver there's a fine line between Travis Bickle being a hero and being a villain. After all, he almost assassinates a senator, but he chickens out, but then he goes and kills a pimp, and he's a hero. Here, Grendel has no redemption of any sort. So this is another passage getting into his mind. His grudges he cherished, murderous malice, many a winter strife unremitting, and peacefully wished he life. Woe to lift from no liegeman at all of the men of the Danefolk. For money to settle, no counselor needed count for a moment on handsome amends at the hands of the murderer. The monster of evil fiercely did harass the ill-planning. Some of this it doesn't make much sense to me, but it is poetry. It's having something to say and then not saying it. That is art. No, and I'm serious about that, in film and literature. You do want your audience to work for it. So, but the ill-planning death shade, both elder and younger, trapping and tricking them. Well, as a student of military history, Grendel has the right strategy here. This is psychological warfare. He is breaking the will of the Danes, and probably would have broken them through his unrelenting offense against the Danes. But the Geats arrive, the Swedish, if I'm not mistaken. That is who the Geats are, that is who Beowulf is. They arrive, and they defeat him. So I have a friend who was in the military who does say for something to be learned, you have to repeat it like about 10,000 times, because most people are just not listening. So hopefully I don't have to repeat the basic theme here of bitterness and envy and jealousy, and to not do it, to resist it. And hopefully also you appreciate the depth of the character in this poem. And But it's worth asking, because I have talked to people who just don't appreciate Beowulf. So they might say, so it has depth, why not just say it? It's the same point for all literary masterpieces. They're not necessarily easy to read. And the poet, it's not the job of the poet to cater to a lazy reader that doesn't want to use their brain and think about what he or she is reading. That's not his job. That's your job, is to think and to read and to respect what you're reading. So Beowulf is a serious poem. It is sophisticated. And if the authors of these poems, like the Iliad, Aeneid, Beowulf, Dante's Inferno, the Divine Comedy, they could condense what they're saying into a few bland paragraphs. And why would they do that? A story is a lot more compelling. And so, with that said, if you recognize the character of Grendel, if you're in a similar place and you're a woman, or if you're somebody like me who kind of went through this at some point, you know, a terribly unsocialized young man, what is a way to fight off the temptations? Well, for me, it was philosophy and serious intellectual discussion about ethics, about values, and self-awareness is key above all. So this was interesting what Plato said in the Republic. I did read the Republic, and it does take more than one read to just absorb it. But he does say something interesting here about who really is rich and who isn't. He says, those who are not rich and find old age a burden, he gives the following advice. A good man may not find old age easy to bear if he's poor, but a bad man won't be at peace with himself even if he is rich. So basically, to sum up what Grendel does not find, in a word, it's contentment. And contentment is possible if you're rich, poor, doesn't matter what your particular, your unique tragedy is that you're trying to cope with, you can be content. And contentment is essential, because if you look at the rich man who is not content, I'm not talking about rich people in general, just someone who is not content, someone who is constantly coveting more and more money, they don't really, I mean, they have the habit of a poor person. It's like they don't act rich because they constantly seem to be in need of something. And so you don't want to be that person. And you definitely don't want to be the person that jealous of other people who just for once finally make it in life and have a respite from their own personal tragedies. So with that, I'll conclude on Grendel. It is worth returning to this epic to discuss the complexity of Beowulf, since the half reads like a eulogy. You know, he does die after a lifetime of hardship, toil, and fighting. And he's warned not to be hubris, as it's every hero has to guard against this. And if there isn't a warning against hubris for a hero in an epic or a tragedy, then it's probably not worth reading. The perfect hero is just not that interesting. This is why I found Grendel so interesting. So with that concluded, thanks for listening. I'll return to Beowulf after I cover a little bit more ground with Greece and Rome. Thanks.